Welcome to another episode of Something Digital Office Hours, where you can ask us your questions about Magento. I'm your host, Brian Lang, and today we are doing our Black Friday special surprise edition.
Woo!
I've got Philip Jackson with me, as usual, and we may even have an appearance from another SD.
It might be another special guest.
Yes, that you've not met yet.
I've got my special Something Digital Camelback edition here today.
Let's see if you can.
Yeah, you see that?
There it is.
Yeah,
so there it is.
The Something Digital sticker, I'm rocking it. We're buckled in. We're locked and loaded for Black Friday.
Perfect. Yeah, and I think Lindsay Pugh will be joining us at 3 p.m., so in just 15 minutes.
That's great. That's great news. Let's see here. We are, and you're recording this, obviously. Yeah, it's live on Facebook. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to tweet this out while we're waiting for Lindsay. We do have a few little items of note. It's been kind of a quiet day as far as Black Friday is concerned.
I guess so.
I mean, there's a few things that have happened, but you know, all in all, it's not the worst day yet, especially for our clients. Something Digital, we seem to be humming along, and nothing really out of the ordinary happening just yet. So that's good. But as you know, I saw some of our folks that we know overseas from quick couple shout outs to Mean B and JH. I'm sorry, yes. Mean B and Space 48, two Magento agencies who just announced a merger, both in the UK, one's in Bath, one's in Manchester. But also JH, who are in Nottingham, and all three of them have all reported that their Magento sites are running well. Everything's going swimmingly today. And they also do the Black Friday Cyber Monday thing, even though they don't celebrate Thanksgiving there. But that means that if you are doing any amount of international business, that your Black Friday starts around 3-4 a.m. Eastern. And it runs, so it starts, you know, London, UK, GMT time, and it runs until late tonight. So a lot of opportunities still for things to pick up, things to heat up. So I'll be sharing out the link now. And Brian, what's your Black Friday experience? You buy anything today?
Not a thing. Not yet.
No?
Not a thing. That's pretty unusual for me. I usually am a bit of a Black Friday shopper. I've even braved the crowds in my past.
Have you really?
Oh, yes.
Oh, my gosh.
Gone in store, did the whole nine yards. It's, you know, it's pretty wild. Although, I think, you know, there's a lot of movement happening from in-store shopping to online shopping, even on Black Friday now.
That's true.
And on Thanksgiving, right? A lot of people are doing, because a lot of these sales are going live on Thanksgiving. And so a lot of stores will open for limited time on Thanksgiving, for good or for worse, for better or worse. They're opening on Thanksgiving.
For good or worse, yep.
Good or worse, yes. But the sales usually start at the beginning of the day on Thanksgiving. And so we're seeing some serious boosts in numbers because people are purchasing starting on Thanksgiving through Black Friday, through the weekend into Cyber Monday. And it's just one long stream of purchasing.
And that's true. Actually, Retail Insider on Twitter asking the question, which is what is this the last true Black Friday, Cyber Monday that we'll have? Because most companies, they started all of this last Friday. So they started a week ago, right? So
yeah, I think it's definitely really confusing for shoppers as well. Like back, you know, 10 years ago, when you went to go shop on Black Friday, you were pretty sure you were going to get the bottom price.
Yeah,
that, you know, that was out there. And, you know, you still had to be a little bit savvy. But like in general, you could go on one day and you would, you know, you could be very happy that, you know, knowing that you probably got the best price. Now with everything all spread out and there being quote unquote, you know, Cyber Week and Cyber Month and whatever, you know, Black November, whatever Black people are November. Calling it.
Yeah, that's true. I like that.
Whatever they're calling it now, it's really hard, I think, for people to be able to discern when to purchase the and when like how good the deals are going to be, and they don't know when to wait either. Like a lot of people, I think, are waiting for Cyber Monday now because it's mm-hmm. sort of the last big day, and so they don't want to buy something and then have to turn around and realize that they could have got it for a better price if they had just waited a little bit longer.
Yeah, and the problem that I've seen, so there are a couple brands that I do follow that I'm a fan of, and the deals that I've seen all started, you know, late last week. So they've been running now for 7 or 8 days. They've called them Black Friday deals. They said, get your Black Friday deals early. I'm assuming they're going to be the same deals through Cyber Monday. And most of the ones that I've been waiting for all week long, waiting for Black Friday to see if there was going to be an additional
deal. Right. Yeah.
Right. There wasn't one. And here's what's worse is they're all out of stock now.
Right.
All of them.
Exactly. Oh yeah, totally. Exactly. No, I had the same thing happen. Actually, I did try to buy one thing, which was the Google Home Mini, and I was going to buy it on Walmart because they had the $25 credit.
Yeah, sure.
And now I'm on a waiting list because I waited, and I shouldn't have waited. That was more of a procrastination thing than anything else. But
that's what all holiday shopping is basically.
That's true. In short, come Cyber Monday, if I'm going to do any more purchasing, like deal hunting, if you will, it's all going to like come down to Monday. There's no doubt about it.
Yeah. I don't know that we're going to see any additional deals. So that's going to be my, a bold prediction is,
maybe
you heard it on my office hours. We're not going to see any additional deals. That's my guess. but I do want to say a little bit, you know, we haven't seen any, we've seen a few big brands with some troubles this afternoon, which I did want to jump into a little bit.
Yeah, let's talk about it.
Yeah, and I do want to talk about the ones that, you know, maybe we've been tracking a little bit, especially for our clients. You know, we love our clients, and we definitely want to give them a bit of a shout out, but I we get into that just a little later, and then take a look, broader look at the industry once Lindsay joins us here in just a little bit. But let me just kind of get into this a little bit. So I actually want to start with a story about Lowe's. The big story here is, who knew that people went shopping at Lowe's.com on Cyber Monday, Black Friday, Cyber Monday. It's kind of
definitely. Yeah, Lowe's has been a big player in the holiday shopping space for a long time.
Yeah, well, but online too. It's kind of amazing.
Yeah.
But the website actually went down, and Lowe's actually acknowledged it and said that their website took a little bit of a hit. So the site is currently offline and will be available in the next hour. That was 11 a.m. Eastern. And, you know, when a website goes down on Black Friday, that's kind of a bad thing, don't you think?
That is a lot of money lost.
Yeah.
Looks like it's back up, just so you know.
Lowe's is back up now, that's for sure.
Down as well. Sorry.
Well, there's a couple, but I was going to ask, do you know what platform Lowe's happens to be running?
Not off the top of my head.
Well, see, we're going to do this now. We're going to do this live. Built with Lowe's.com.
WebSphere.
Yeah,
WebSphere. Not surprising.
Yeah, sure. One thing that I thought was really interesting that, you know, you're seeing a lot of right now, and I don't know if this is a Google thing or if it's a... you know, if it's a new tactic, and it's certainly something, another story I want to get into. The Lowe's changed. This is bonkers to me. I don't even understand this. And maybe this is, I can't wait for Lindsay to dissect this a little bit. If you go to Lowe's, or go to Google, type in Lowe's. Okay. You're going to have to be in the United States, I'm assuming, because Lowe's is a primarily North American brand. Type in Lowe's, L-O-W-E-S, and the title tag and the H1 and the meta description. Here, let me just take over. Let me show my screen. This is gonna blow your mind. Here we go. Can we do this? Is this easy to do? It is. Look at that. Okay. Can you see my screen?
Oh, yes.
Okay, so check this out, right? So I go to Lowe's, I type it in, L-O-W-E-S, and they're what is effectively their H1 tag, their meta description, and basically when I click through to the homepage, oh, it didn't do it this time. I wonder if that's, was it just?
it's possible.
It's going to make a fool out of me. It's going to make a fool out of me. Hold on. Lowe's.com. Let me do it from, not from organic. Let me type it direct. It didn't do it this time. So maybe it's something about me. So
it could be when they brought their site back up, they lost that.
It could be. So when I first queued it up, and this is the thing that, this was another story with games.co.uk, they actually did a soft redirect of the homepage to their Black Friday deals. So all homepage traffic was being redirected to their Black Friday deal site, which is, it is on Lowe's.com proper, but it is, you know, stuff
the Black Friday category.
Right, exactly. Which, yeah, prioritizing is, you know, Christmas trees and washers and dryers, as you would expect. But I find that really, really interesting because
those are their Black Friday deals.
Yeah. Yeah. This is it,
man.
These are big. This is a big thing. I mean, a lighted minion Christmas inflatable, bro. That's for $69. I mean, you can't even beat that. That's good stuff.
It was $150. So, yeah. You know.
Oh, this is actually really, really nice little accessibility here. The tabbable. Okay. All right. Sorry. Now I'm geeking out. I actually really like this. I think it's really interesting. So they have a deal, you know, deal sub site, like a deal category, which I think is, you know, a lot of people have done. But beyond just the deal category, the fact that they were, you know, the bravery for them to change their
H1s.
Yeah. I mean, basically, right? That's effectively what they've done. Let's geek out just a little further.
I'd love to have Lindsay on for this right now. She would love this.
Yeah. Sure.
She'll
come back. We're going to just keep teasing Lindsay. Lindsay will be here in just a minute. Yeah. Lindsay's our social media genius and our digital marketing guru. And she'll be joining us here in just a minute. One other story that was in the same vein, and it's probably the reason why I recognized it on Lowe's when it happened, was that game.co.uk had a really interesting Black Friday strategy as well, which had all the same sort of trappings. They changed their H1 tags and they were redirecting site traffic they were doing a soft redirect as well to a deal category. But the looks like the website went down for some period of time.
The strategy was too good to handle.
Yeah, it's a little too good. It's interesting, you know, this is a UK brand, so it's a little bit different for us. But it's interesting, you know, the reliance on organic here is interesting because the with you're basically relying on Google to pick up the change and you know, basically reflect that change within, you know, a pretty crucial period of time. So you can see from the organic result that it did pick up the H1 change for game, but they also, you know, they'd prioritized their own PPC. So the PPC was also, reflecting the same. But I thought that was really interesting. And it could be one of those things that, you know, if you are looking for a digital marketing strategy for next Black Friday, maybe that's something that you do as well. And maybe we can go into a couple of,
or even like do a really quick turnaround and do it for Cyber Monday.
Oh, that might be. Yeah. That might be an interesting thing. I mean, it depends on whether Google will be able to pick it up in time.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think that's kind of the key here is that this is primarily for organic. It's interesting. Of course, when everyone's doing it, I start to doubt whether it's actually worth it or not. But we'll see. So yeah. I thought that was really interesting. Another interesting thing that came across to me was a deal I got in email and I haven't been able to find anywhere else, which is the a brand that I like is Cole Haan. And Cole Haan has this is Cole Haan's website, and they're offering 50% off. They've been doing this for a week now, maybe longer. And they're one of those brands that they're basically all out of the things that I would have wanted, and in the sizes that I would have wanted. But this 50% off sale, I got an email from their payment partner, PayPal. And this is, Cole Haan is like notorious for having this, what I call a, the NASCARification of their website. So if you look at how many badges they have for checkout, how many, this is less than it used to be. It used to be way worse than this. But I don't know if you can see that there, coming across in screen share, but here's Affirm, right? And here's, you know, a million payment types, yada, yada. What I find really interesting is that, they did an additional thing, which here, I'm going to stop the share so you don't read my email. One second. I'm going to pull this up. You're going to love this. Here we go. All right. How do I restart the share? Share. There we go. Okay. So here's the email that I got. An additional 10% off for you for shopping at colehaan.com with a special coupon for PayPal. Now, what happens is if I click through, it goes to PayPal and it's doing like a campaign redirect, which I thought was really interesting. And then the homepage personalization changes. You see that? So it actually,
that's cool.
It follows me around. So I get the PayPal tout as I move around the site. When I go over to the shopping cart, it actually will tell me, hey, don't, oh, it didn't do it. Oh, here it is. It'll tell me, hey, don't forget to use that, that special offer code. So you can save an additional 10%, which I just thought was, you know,
awesome. Super cool. Yeah, super cool.
Really, really cool. And that is the kind of deal I was looking for that was going to make me pull the trigger. But these guys are out of stock on the things that I need. So it's kind of a bummer.
Yeah, that is one of the most frustrating thing, I think. And I saw this, a couple articles about this, but shoppers are pretty mad about people being out of stock. I think the article is about Walmart being out of stock and how shoppers were very angry. They couldn't get their Black Friday deal, which happens every year. Nothing new, but it's interesting. Like, if something's not a last leader for you, make sure you have a lot of it.
Sure.
Because, you know, loss leaders are obviously something that you should have limited stock on. You're trying to get people in your stores, and you know, you've got limited quantity. But if you feel confident about your margins and you're gonna run a sale on something that you want to sell a lot of, make sure you have a lot of stock, because
it's so what you're saying, Brian, is that to sell something, you have to sell something.
You have to have it to sell it.
Yeah. So Lindsay's here. Lindsay's going to join us in just a second. I just promoted her to a panelist.
Great.
There we go.
Hey, Lindsay.
She's going to have to unmute.
Oh, yes.
You're live, so make sure your hair and makeup are all sweet. Like, Brian spent about 20 minutes doing his makeup. Just
always.
Oh, you're muted. We can't hear you.
There we go. Hey, Lindsay.
Hey, how are you guys?
Real good.
Good. Good.
We've been building you up. So
we have. That's true.
You now have to live up to the hype.
Oh, geez. All right.
one thing that I did want to throw over to you, we're going to just throw you right into the thick of it, was there was an article that came over on econsultancy.com, which I'll actually pull back up because we just talked about it, but I want to get your take here. Okay. So eConsultancy did a bit of a breakdown on how game.co.uk launched what they called their most impressive Black Friday digital strategy in 2017, which basically reads to me like, you know, those guys, it's like a pay-for-play ad on eConsultancy.com. But anyway, it doesn't all get rosy because their site went down for a little bit. But they did something really interesting, which was they changed their H1 tag on the homepage to mention Black Friday on certain categories of items, phones and consoles. Mm-hmm. And then they did once you click through, they actually do a soft redirect to their Black Friday deal site, which is like a subdomain site for them, And it was a category page takeover that was, you know, Black Friday specific, which would, you know, I guess go away after Black Friday is over. Right. And I was telling Brian that I thought that that was sort of bold. It's like, you know, it's like an organic strategy specifically just to capture a certain type of buyer, over, you know, and you're putting a lot of trust in Google to pick those kinds of changes up in a timely manner. So I just thought maybe you had some off the cuff thoughts about that, and maybe how someone might be able to, someone that, you know, is a smaller site might be able to utilize that kind of a strategy.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's really smart. I actually hadn't seen anyone doing that until you pulled that up, but it's kind of one of those, duh, why wouldn't you try it? Right. I mean, there's really no harm in making the change. And if it pans out, then you could potentially see really nice returns. It kind of reminds me of like what BuzzFeed does with their links for social sharing, how they've started labeling their URLs specifically for shares on Facebook. It kind of is like, I mean, it's an organic strategy, but it feels sort of similar to that, in that they're doing it just specifically to get more traction for, you know, certain sales or certain pages.
That's good. Yeah. It's the first time I've seen it as well, or at least paid attention to it. I may have seen it before. And then we saw Lowe's did the exact same thing, which is pretty interesting that see two retailers do it. It's probably something that's been done before is my guess, but good to call it out.
I'm curious if that also helps with PPC placement. By having content on the homepage that's specific, or on your landing pages that are specific to a Black Friday deal, if you're trying to buy specifically for Black Friday traffic.
Oh, for sure. I bet if especially for actually get good search volume for, you know, whatever their brand is plus Black Friday, that probably really benefits them from like a CPC standpoint.
Yeah. Is there anyone in the Something Digital roster that is doing anything interesting around PPC, or is it just sort of the same sort of strategies? Anything that you have to do that's different for Black Friday, Cyber Monday?
Nothing in particular. It's kind of the same old. I haven't really seen anyone doing anything like crazy exciting from a like CPC standpoint. Mm-hmm. I mean, definitely like making sure your promotional feed is working for Google Shopping. I feel like that's something that's super important, especially if you're a brand that does well there. You know, for CPC, just getting your promotional copy updated. But I haven't really seen anybody doing anything like bold and really interesting. I mean, people will use the countdown features or like more dynamic search ads around the holiday times. But I haven't seen anything that I've been really like, oh my God, that's what an incredible strategy. But maybe I just haven't dived deep enough yet.
Are there any particular brands that you follow that that you look for specifically on this week of deals that, you know, that you're interested in? I covered a couple, and I said that one of the things that was frustrating for me was Cole Haan. I followed just because I like their shoes, but they ran a promotion all week long of 50% off a lot of things, mostly seasonal items. And so I was waiting for Black Friday to see if maybe they kicked a little extra, and they didn't, but now they have no stock of anything left. So it's a really frustrating sort of experience as a shopper who's been trained to wait until the last minute to not get the payoff. So anyone you're following specifically?
I always look at All Saints. They're a UK company. They do like leather jacket. They have 40% off everything on the site this year, which I didn't really follow them last year. So I'm not sure if that's comparable with what they've offered, but it seemed like a really good deal to me, and there were no exclusions on it. And they really just promoted it on social, email, all kind of standard. I always follow like J. Crew and Madewell to see what they do, because they'll often have like in-store promotions that are different than what they offer online. And this year they did like a couple of little freebie in-store things. But nothing really crazy. I haven't personally, any of the brands that I've followed, seen them do anything wild. It's been either like anywhere from 25 to 50% off, or just specific like sale category markdowns.
So you're keeping a running list right now of something digital clients, and I thought maybe we could go through a couple of those to kind of get an idea of the kinds of deals that we're seeing sort of in aggregate, or maybe some techniques that people are using to advertise on sites.
Yeah, we can take a look at some of them. I've got a list of all of the promotions that are currently being offered. I mean, we are seeing more frequently this year the sale category. In the past, I definitely haven't. Actually, I don't think last year any of our clients really were doing that. It was more, you know, just either a promotion code deal or, you know, markdown, like price slashing. But this year it seems to be driving to a specific category that has markdowns from X to X. So, you know, it'll be like from, let's say anywhere from 25 to 40% off markdowns already marked in a sale category, only that category, no additional promotions. So that was something really popular that we saw. We do have a couple of clients that are doing promotions exclusive to channels. So there are a couple that are doing, you know, additional 10 or 15% off with social promotion codes, PPC promotion codes, email promotion codes. We have one client that is only offering discount via email. There's nothing on the site, actually. It's just kind of like a private email sale only.
Very cool.
Which I think is interesting, and I'll be curious to see if that works out for them. I don't know. They also are big in catalog mailings. Like they do a lot of catalog sales also. So maybe they just figured like, hey, that's where we get most of our play anyway. Let's just offer a discount only to people that actually subscribe.
You know, it's pretty interesting. This is pretty cool. One of our clients actually made deal news today.
Who's
Villa.
That?
Villa.
Oh, wow. Okay. You want to bring it up and show the site? I kind of like repping them a little bit if we can. I wouldn't mind.
Yeah, let's do it.
Just as an aside, I just saw it come across Twitter. It looks like Target's site went down for a bit. That's kind of
not surprising. I feel like it goes down or gets really slow. No, it goes down or gets slow every Black Friday.
Yeah.
This
is not surprising, this is.
All right. Hold on. Here's my screen. Can you see it?
Yep. Got it.
Cool. Yeah, so.
Oh, yeah.
Villa.
So Villa is
60% off.
Villa is a Philadelphia sort of sneaker slash. It's like a sneakerhead brand, or traditionally a sneakerhead brand that's kind of going broad into footwear and athletic sort of apparel.
Yeah.
They have a beautiful site. I've always
liked it. Really do. I've always liked their site. And they have some really beautiful shoes on their site.
What's really funny about Villa is of all of our clients, they probably have the most Black Friday-esque traffic like every week of the year. Because if you're not familiar with the way footwear works, they especially in sneakers, they have these exclusives that they do where they only sell, you know, 200 pairs. So you have like hundreds of thousands of people all trying to buy the same 200 pair of shoes all at one time when those exclusives are announced. So it's, you know, it's one of those sort of things that tends to be very spiky traffic.
These are sweet.
We're going to watch Brian shop now. What is your Black Friday deal category? Oh, this is that deal category, isn't it?
It is. Yeah. I'm in it right now. Actually, it's interesting. I noticed on their homepage, let me go back. They said they had 60% off, up to 60% off, but then their hero banner was 50% off footwear. And then extra 25% off select items. Interesting. It is interesting to see how some of these promotions work and how people advertise them, and and then how they get covered in the news. Like we saw on Deal News, they picked up on the up to 60% off. It's interesting, you know, it almost feels like you should offer up to a much higher number percentage off, like they did there, where they offered up to 60, even though the majority of their site may have been, you know, in the 50 range. They have a couple items that fall into a category so that you get picked up by news outlets and deal sites for having up to a certain percentage off.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool.
So that's interesting. So Lindsay, just to kind of throw it back over to you, you mentioned to me earlier that you saw a bunch of companies doing, you know, specific just deal categories or categories, certain I wasn't quite following it at the time, so maybe you could elaborate a bit.
Oh yeah, so like how Villa has the 50% off category, it's right. Not like a promotional code that you apply on top of it. And I'm interested in like the psychology of the online shopping deal. You know, do people find it more satisfying to have that additional promo code that you know, takes more money off that they can put in their cart, or is it like more satisfying to just go on and be like, oh, this is cheap, let me add it? Just looking at our clients that are doing the category versus last year promo code, it looks like it is trending a little bit down. Like people are not resonating as much with it, although it's hard to compare them exactly because Black Friday started much earlier this year. So that could also be part of it. It could just be that people are shopping more throughout the week instead of on the actual day.
We talked about that. Yeah, it's definitely happening. And we also mentioned it's really hard. I'd like to hear your thoughts on this. It's really hard for shoppers now to discern when they're going to get the best prices. It used to be a lot easier. Do you have any thoughts on whether that's good or bad, how to combat it, or maybe use it to your advantage?
I mean, I think it's definitely a bit of an issue this year. I've seen people complaining about it on social media, where this year especially, there's the expectation of like, oh, brands are going to be ramping up sales. If I wait, I'm going to get a great deal. And that really hasn't panned out. And like Philip said, it's either brands running out of stock or, you know, the deal just being stagnant or actually dropping. So I think it's definitely causing frustration with consumers. And I would be interested, and I don't know if any brands are doing this, but I feel like a cool strategy to try would be complete transparency of deals. Like, these are our deals, we're offering them X date to X date. I haven't seen anyone do that, especially like if you're not offering staggered deals. Let's say, you know, you're a retailer and you're just going to offer 50% off on one day only or 2 days only, like upfront letting your consumers know, or maybe your top tier of consumers know.
Interesting. Like almost like a deal calendar.
Like mark it down. This is when our sale is happening. Or even just offering like additional better deals to your top tier customers. I haven't seen much of that this year either. I don't know. Those are two things I would be curious to try if I were a retailer. Because I feel like there's definitely a level of frustration that people are getting annoyed with. And I'll be curious to see if like overall that impacts this Black Friday, Cyber Monday week compared to last year.
So two things for you there, Lindsay. I woke up this morning and my email was ridiculous. I had maybe, 30, 40. It was, 7 a.m. I had 30 or 40 emails from every brand that I follow. And those were the ones that weren't trapped by unroll.me, right? So those are the ones that somehow made it through. Which, I both love and hate that service, but that's a whole nother topic. So my question for you is, from a email marketing standpoint, how do you even stand out if it's not 30% off, 40% off, or 50% off? How do you even stand out and sort of rise above the fold from an email marketing perspective? Is you have any tips on that?
I mean, I almost kind of feel like it's setting a good precedent for your email marketing content throughout the year. Like I know personally, there's nothing that is going to get me to open an email from a brand that I find lackluster. Even if it's like 75% off in the subject line, I just do not care. But if you can consistently send out really nice emails that are beautiful, and you have like nice gift guides, good content, things I find useful, even if it's not a great deal, I'm still going to open it just to see if there's additional stuff you can offer me. So I feel like he is just making your email marketing on point throughout the year, really winning over customer loyalty, and then using social media to supplement people that are just like auto deleting everything.
Good advice. I think this whole thing that we're talking about, and you basically said, don't just make it all about Black Friday. Like Black Friday should just be an extension of the fact that you're already doing this and you're doing it well. I think Deborah Weinzweig said recently, and she's a retail analyst at Fung Global Retail and Technology. She said basically that Black Friday is, and we've already kind of explored this topic, but consumers are basically treating the entire year like it's Black Friday now. Like they're able to really shop sales and use these deal sites. I remember when Deal News first started, it was like really all about Black Friday, but then they kind of switched and it was like where every day is Black Friday. And now people are really use these sites like sickdeals.net and others to set up the price alerts. And you've got email marketing happening at probably the same rate all year long as it's happening at Black Friday. And you've got, you know, similar headlines and deep, sometimes even deeper discounts than you would on Black Friday. So I think your point is really well made. You have to be doing this stuff year round, and you need to be, you know, you need to be doing it well year round. You can't just make it all about now, because that expectation is changing.
Yeah. Just speaking of Deborah, since you mentioned her, I'm on her Twitter. So she's doing the hard work for all of us who get to just sit and tweet all day.
Thanks, Deborah.
thank you so much, Deborah. She says, heavy traffic in women's shoes at Macy's. Which mall is she at? I can't remember right now. Nike flagship store is very crowded. Where is she? Hold on. I should have figured this out before.
New York. New York.
Yeah. She's in New York somewhere. Hold on. I'll find out. She's tweeting like crazy right now. She doesn't say where. She just picked it up. All right. Well, it doesn't matter. Okay. Let's just kind of dig in a little bit. She said the lines out the door at Banana Republic. That might be the first time since like 1998 that there's been a line out the door at Banana Republic. 50% off full price purchases. Hot items include fur vests, skinny pants. Awesome. She calls them skinny pants. That's my new word. I'm going to change my... let's see. Nike flagship store is very crowded, but it's not so rosy when you get into the big, Keystone department chains. Heavy traffic in women's shoes at Macy's, but Bloomingdale's not so much. Saks, 60% off select items at Saks. Looks like Saks is really, look at that. That looks busy.
That looks pretty busy.
Yeah.
Saks looks busy. Anthropology, 30% off. I love this one. DJ at Lululemon playing music so loud that it's driving people away. Nordstrom traffic is light. Kate Spade, 30% off. So she's doing all the hard work for us. Thank you, Deborah.
I was reading an article in, I think it was the New York Times, that said that Dallas Mall lines were actually not that bad.
Yeah.
I think, again, this plays back to something we said earlier, which is that a lot of people are moving from offline to online. And so I think, you know, back in the early 2000s up through even the late 2000s, some of those lines, I remember, like, it was big news. People are camping out, and I just don't see those headlines anymore.
No,
there's no campouts. There's no, you know, kumbaya while they try to stay warm around a fire.
Well, my sense too is that, you know, this is the second year where we're basically looking at online retail really combating and taking away, it's siphoning off what the brick and mortar retail has done. We definitely see mobile traffic being the new norm for sites. If you just look at Google Analytics real time right now, tremendous amount of mobile traffic for lots of our clients. So it's interesting. I I do want to take 1 minute, and I do want to pull up a couple of our clients. Let's see here. I did want to highlight a couple of our new launches. This is where I'm stalling for time because I don't know how to use computers anymore because I'm just old. So a new launch for us is fuzzybaba.com. Best.
This is a great gift, by the way, for your best, kids.
Ever the salesman. This is the best new site launch. I love the look and feel of the site, and the slippers and like socky type slippers are really fun. Black Friday sale for them is 30% off any 3+ pairs. Sounds like a good deal. So definitely want to check them out. Oh, look at these foxes. That's cute. What does that have to be for women? I want that. That's awesome. I want to dig. Okay. Now I'm just going to go shopping with you guys on screen share.
Oh,
it's pretty cool. So they've got a really neat site. This is a Magento 2 site. Really like this particular site launch. And this was our SD accelerator too.
Correct.
Yeah, I'm liking this. Yeah. What is our accelerator? I don't think we've ever talked about it on Office Hours.
Yeah, that's because it's kind of our secret sauce.
don't tell anybody.
No, you can go check it out on our website. It's one of our offerings. It's a very quick way to get up and running on Magento. And I think if you're looking to do an upgrade to Magento 2, or if you're looking to migrate from another site or build a site from scratch, this is honestly one of the best and fastest ways to get up and running that's out there. And so if you're looking to build a site, come talk to us about that after the show.
So there's that. So that was Fuzzy Baba. Another one that we recently launched is Home Wet Bar. They've got they've got a really nice gift guide. Check that out. They've got a gift guide. I'll open that up in a new window. Or I'll open that up in this window. Why not? And so really nice gift guide landing page for them. Oh, that's really pretty. I like that.
Yeah. They did a good job.
These guys always know how to really know how to do it. You know, they've really got it nailed down. Here's gifts under 25, gifts under 50.
Funny Christmas gifts. I like that. That's a good category. Yeah.
Site's really fast. You like how I'm working in the, all the self compliments. They've got some interesting products. Oh, look at that. Kevin, the man, the myth, the legend. I like that. Okay.
There you go.
So that's that. Home Wet Bar, they're really cool. I like it. They've got stinking fast site.
Magento 2, if you do it right, it's pretty snappy. It's pretty snappy.
The ultimate flashlight grill tongs. I mean,
just what I need.
I didn't know that I needed it, but now I do.
Actually, that's I know someone I could have got that for.
Let's see who else. Saludos. I know who else. Let's see. What's the next?
What about Uno?
Uno, that's a good one.
They have some tiered Black Friday deals, I think.
Right,
I like tiered deals. That's good. That's another good one.
Tiers are cool. I don't know how to type. Uno alla volta. This is where there it's two L's, Philip. Okay. There we go. Nice big prominent banner at the top. Nice tiered discount, code. So let's go into their
look at that. They're leveraging I think both Fuzzy Baba and Uno alla volta leverage that persistent strap at the top.
Mm-hmm.
Which I really like because it's such a bold call out that's persistent.
This year up here,
for their Black Friday deal. Good.
Yeah, I like that.
In addition to hero call outs,
it's interesting. If Brian, do you want me to get you this kimono? This kimono I think that's on point.
It's pretty cool.
Life actually it's actually really cool. so really neat. That's actually the first really creative deal that I've seen. Most everybody else is offering a percentage off, and this is sort of stacked. This is more what I would expect from a larger retailer. Like this is almost the everyday deal that you would see at like an Express or a New York and Company or something like that, right?
Yeah.
Which I've it's kind of an interesting you don't see this too often online unless it's a retailer like that.
Some of the bigger, more established retailers. And this kind of speaks to their audience. I think that, you know, they've done a good job of researching their audience. They know their consumer very well. And I think it's really fitting for their consumer.
So the largest discounts that we see in our host or our compliments of all our clients, at least from the list that I have, maybe Lindsay, you know, some better ones, is a brand called Maddie Style. So Maddie Ziegler, she's a dance personality. She was on Dancing with, she was a judge on So You Think You Can Dance, but she was a reality TV star on Dance Moms for.
Well, and wasn't she the dancer in
Sia's music video? Yeah.
Chandelier music video, which was really, I mean,
that small thing that you may not have seen. So this is one of our clients. We built the site. We're really proud of it. I've always liked the site. So Black Friday, they have up to 40% off, I think, here.
This is a great site because we put a lot of work into, you know, their market is sort of tween girls and teenage girls, and this had some sort of COPPA considerations.
This came up during that conversation, the talk that I gave about broad compliance, which covered COPPA back at Magento Imagine 20
last year.
Interesting stuff. Oh, well, we like this brand a lot, and it looks like there's up to 40% off. I'm looking for a 40% off. I don't see one yet. Hold on, let's do the high to low. Oh, there's one, a vegan leather jacket. There we go. That's looking good.
Philip, nice. you bought a jean jacket. How about a leather jacket?
I will not and shall not buy a jean. Now I'm definitely going to buy a leather jacket.
Now you're definitely going to buy a leather jacket.
Lindsay has the hookups on leather jackets. That's
this content will be on Facebook, or is on Facebook. So now Facebook is definitely listening.
Sure,
you're going to get some ads for a leather jacket now.
What's really interesting about this particular sale is the use of the category pricing, like the catalog rule pricing.
Yes.
So you get the strike through. So nice look there. And there's the same sort of persistent banner that you see at the top, like Brian mentioned before. But anyway, so that's a little sampling of some of our clients. And, you know, there's a lot more. Most of them, I think, on average, are offering about 25 to 30% off.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I wonder if those prices will drop or remain consistent on Cyber Monday.
That's something interesting to track. So I want to throw it back over to Lindsay and ask. So what happens after Black Friday and Cyber Monday? How do you measure the success or the efficacy of some of those digital marketing campaigns that they're running right now?
I'm trying to think of like a good example. I guess, you know, we probably would want to do a review of each of our clients probably at the end of next week. I think a lot of them actually have sales that'll be running potentially past Cyber Monday.
Mm-hmm.
But it is definitely going to be a little difficult to measure success year over year, just because the promotional period and both the promotions offered have differed so much. But I mean, we'll still be monitoring KPIs across channel. So standard stuff like looking at conversion rate on certain pages, you know, if they did have a specific category page that they were driving traffic to for sales, we would want to look at CVR there, you know, number of transactions, average order value, all kind of standard stuff there. I know with, you know, CPC, we're looking a lot at cost per click, especially if, you know, the client had like a custom landing page we were driving traffic to, we would hope to see that come down over time. But, you know, really, really just the same success measures that we use year round. And then, you know, trying to do some adjustment for the period and the promos being different this year.
Right. It's like you're going to expect your metrics to be different, and you should have like some historicals on that so that you can benchmark against that period, not just your general season metrics. I have another question for you, Lindsay. What about after Christmas? Obviously, there's quite a push with sales after Christmas. There's a lot of inventory left over to get rid of, and people are trying to, to also return items. And so as people go and return items to stores, do you have some strategies for how, you might be able to capture, additional sales during that period, or other post-Christmas strategies that you might have?
Yeah. I mean, one thing that I will say that I'm always surprised that retailers don't do a better job at is, especially for online returns, a lot of, especially retailers that I shop, will not offer free returns. There'll be a fee based on, shipping carriers. So like Anthropology will do, they'll sometimes offer like free shipping on orders of $150. But if you do a return, it's $5.95 for the return. And I think that kind of kills consumers to have to pay that, because we're so conditioned to have the free shipping, free returns.
Mm-hmm.
But I think there should be, and oftentimes too, it'll be free, free exchange. So you can't return it for free, but you can exchange it for free. So I think retailers should do a better job of pushing people to do the exchange, because it's free shipping back, you get a new thing. I think we could be utilizing like ESPs a lot more to try to push those additional exchange items instead of just, letting a customer go through with the return.
It seems like be an opportune time to also do it didn't quite meet what you're looking for. Here are other options that are similar, but that might fall within the scope of what you were looking for type.
Right.
It's almost like customers who bought also like sort of type promotion, just to try and give them some alternatives than a straight return. Like, instead of returning, why don't you exchange for this? Give them examples of things they could do instead of a straight return.
But that's a really good example of the kind of thing that you would probably expect to be offered in store. Either the in-person experience. And I think maybe the what we're lacking there is the conversational component, not to get too future commerce on it, but that is the kind of transaction. It's really hard to provide a useful UI or UX for a customer to self-service themselves for a replacement item, whereas it's a little easier to do if you were pushing people into conversational. So
Amazon does a really good job of this. I feel like when you go to do the return, of course, Amazon's returns are unbelievable in general, but
Amazon does everything incredibly, right?
They do everything incredibly, yeah. But I'm just going to point something out. They definitely do a really good job of surveying you as you're returning the item. And so I think maybe that's one step that would be good to have. It's like maybe include some sort of a required fields about why they're returning. And if they select certain, options, it might present them with some other things they could do besides return. So.
Right. I also like the brand Everlane is utilizing Facebook Messenger really well. So if you start a return through them, somebody will actually ask you via your whole receipt, which is in Facebook Messenger, was something wrong with this product? Can I help you find something else? So they've kind of removed the step of you having to use a chat bot, and they just automatically have an open line of dialogue with you that they can, utilize whenever you start the return process.
Yeah, that's good. It's really good. Yeah, there are several pieces of software out there that, that can assist with post-purchase stuff. So I think we've worked with Narvar
L-I-N-C.
L-I-N-C, correct. I think it's getlink.com or is it link?
Link.
No. Link Global?
Let's Link.
Let's Link.
L-I-T-S-L-I-N-C. Full disclosure, Brian and I, just because there's like all sort of like FCC rules now on this stuff, Brian and I have in the past received compensation from Link
True.
For other podcast future commerce. So just keep that in mind. But they also provide that sort of Facebook Messenger one-to-one communication, post-sale purchase bot experience. I like them a lot. I do think that even if a retailer, if all they did was just pop a Facebook Messenger, you know, thing in their contact us or in their return policy, just put the widget. Just serve it yourself. That's all you have to do. You don't have to do anything fancy. Just let me talk to you and, you know, do what you're already doing in other channels. If you realistically are a brand of any size, you likely already have the infrastructure in place to handle it. You have call center employees. You probably are already doing chat somewhere else in your organization. Just let the customers reach out to you the way that they want to. It's to your benefit. So yeah, I like Everlane too. They've come up in a couple stories recently.
They have.
They definitely have a social good component to their brand and their message. And I really like that, their experience of their website now, they've done something called the Black Friday Fund, which actually, you know what? Hold on. Let me pull that up.
Yeah, it's brands like Everlane, REI, Patagonia, mm-hmm. Yeti that I think instill loyalty in their social good component. This is great.
Yeah, it's going to be a little janky, I'm sure. And the video will probably not work very well over the Zoom meeting, but the Black Friday Fund is effectively trying to build a farm for free healthy meals every day for 4,000 workers. And they're trying to raise funds for doing that with a goal of $300,000 to do it. And they're tracking it. It's at the top of their website. That is their whole, it's like, you know, instead of us just telling you about all the deals, you know, we're promoting the social message in what we do here, which I think is really powerful. On the other end of the scale, a company that's, you know, I had this open while you guys were talking, you know, a company that's sort of questionable about its social good is Apple. They interestingly, Adorama has a current gen MacBook Pro. This might win the best deal for me that I've seen yet, which is a 34% off or $1,000 off a current generation 15-inch MacBook Pro.
That's a really good deal.
$1,899. That might be the best deal that I've seen, and a lot better than Apple's own deal, which is you get a $150 gift card if you buy that same Mac.
Thanks, Apple.
It's a little bit better. Wow. Just a little bit better than this particular deal, which they make it so hard for you even find where the buy button is on this particular site. But yeah. Current gen 2.9 is still $27.99, and you'll get a $150 gift card if you buy it today. Well, that's good. Anyway, interesting.
Speaking of Apple, I've seen a lot of deals on iPads. Does anyone, either of you know if people are like how are people still really buying iPads at a very like high rate? One, they last a long time, so I know.
But what is the traffic like for iPads or tablets?
I'm curious about that. Yeah,
Lindsay would know.
Usually, yeah. Small. I would say for most of our clients, it's like between 10 to 15%.
Yeah, that's actually pretty good. Like that's more than I expected. Yeah.
It depends too on the client. Like, you know, a client that has a lot, a bigger young demographic, like Jack Rogers, I don't think theirs is that high. Theirs is probably below 10%.
Hmm.
But sometimes the iPad traffic, it really just depends. I bet Uno Alla Volta is high.
Yeah, I'm sure it's high. Yeah.
But I would guess their audience is a little old. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely skews toward the an older demographic too. It's interesting. I would like to almost see a breakdown, and this is where my, you know, where I get a little bit curmudgeon-y about the way that the responsive web is, because I don't sense that every deal is right for everyone and that every deal converts the same on every platform. So my thought is that you know, the responsive web has democratized the way that we design and deliver sites, but it's like, you know, the same experience for all. But in actuality, like, you know, I'm more intrigued, I think, by that Cole Haan.
Personalized.
The Cole Haan, I got 10% off because I'm a PayPal consumer who also shops at Cole Haan. I could stack that deal. And then the site was personalized for me when I got there. That showed that deal and it followed me around. That's way more compelling to me as a shopper. Of course, I do, you know, probably more than 50% of my shopping happens online for most things.
I like where you're headed, Philip, and I'm going to do a quick plug for Future Commerce because get ready for our episode coming. Yeah.
There's an episode coming up we'll be doing about deep e-commerce, right?
That's deep e-commerce. Well, no, our predictions episode is where I was headed with that. Yeah.
Okay. Well, yeah. What I'm saying is that it's probably not better for everyone, but when it works out well for me, I like it. How's that? It's
fair. Fair.
I think it's really hard to operationalize that as a business, just as a marketing department, trying to keep all those plates spinning of who, like which segment of customers gets the best deal. How do we even reveal those on the website? They're hard to test. They're hard to service, you know, God forbid there's refunds involved. How does accounting even like some of these things become very difficult to handle as a business. So I understand why more people don't do them, but for the companies that can, I mean, I can't think of anything better in my mind than, you know, a used to be frequent shopper who is inactive now getting the best tier of deal to bring them back and reactivate them, you know, like that.
Yep.
Such a no-brainer. Anyway.
I agree. No doubt.
Okay. Last words.
A couple more sites that had some trouble.
Oh, yeah.
Macy's. Did we mention Macy's yet?
No, we didn't mention Macy's. They had a dumpster fire.
Last year their entire site went down, like completely down, right?
Yeah.
And now this year, all of a sudden PayPal was having an issue, and then all of a sudden, I think all of their credit cards went down completely.
Yeah, there was many, many reports on Twitter of people standing in line at Macy's in their brick and mortar stores, and their payment system was down like nationwide. So they were turning people away. In fact, people that were calling for website support, they were calling into customer service, actually had hangups. Again, according to people on Twitter, people saying basically, hey, nothing we can do right now. Call back later. Which is probably the most honest, you know, approach. That's true.
Also, it looks like Nike site went down briefly for a little while. And also the perfume shop and a few others. But yeah, I would say Macy's is probably the most notable and Lowe's.
Just again, in the vein of things that I track, because this is just how my brain works. I do want to point this particular thing out, which I thought was interesting. So Hoka One One, they're a running shoe brand. So I found them while a lot of people seem to talk about them in the running circles, and I've been trying to pretend like I'm a runner recently. So what's
not
really
pretend, man? You've been running. Running hard.
I don't run like Lindsay runs, but anyway. So
you not discount yourself.
What's interesting about Hoka is their this offer, which it took me by surprise, but it was like the most genius thing ever. It's like frustrating as someone in the space who understands what they're doing. But I kind of love the value play here because they're doing probably what most retailers don't ever do ever. So it's pretty obvious to me where their breakpoint of their AOV is. They kind of basically just tell you like, we need you to spend more than our average order value for this to be worthwhile for us. What's really interesting, so you can save 25%, and that's just flat across the board. So if you look at, let me go to a current generation shoe. Actually, let me just hit sale. It's going to be easier. Oh yeah, this is actually previous generation. I just bought this shoe. I own this shoe right here. And I bought this shoe for $130. It's on sale for $104, which is great, but it is below the AOV. Right. So it makes a lot of sense, right? Why now that if I want to get the beanie, I have to spend $125 or more. Guess what? I'm not gonna bother you to go looking for it on the site. You cannot find really a $20, $25 item on the site. So it's encouraging. The AOV actually is pushing up to 150s. If you want to get the free shipping, free returns, 30-day guarantee, free beanie, you know.
Is that beanie actually for sale on their site anywhere? I'd be kind of curious.
That's a good question. Nice little on-site PLA too.
Yeah, that's sweet.
Say again?
It is a cool beanie. Like, I would want it.
I kind of like it.
I know. That's why I'm wondering if it's available for purchase anywhere, because
let's see if their site search is worth anything. It's not. Okay. They must be running Magento. I'm just kidding. Let's see.
What are they running?
I don't know. Maybe you could look that up while I'm looking.
I'll do that.
I don't think the beanie's available anywhere, you guys. Hold on. Oh, here's an idea.
Well, that's really interesting. I like that a lot.
Oh, here. So their new arrivals, the cheapest thing you can find is a $44 item. What's the cheapest thing in sale? Because this is like the pricing psychology. $13 visor, which also doesn't hit with the $104 shoe. That $104, because Philip can't math, plus 14. That's 20, 128. I guess if you needed a visor, I don't know why you'd need a visor to get a beanie. But if you needed a visor, that's the smallest amount. The smallest amount you can spend while buying a shoe is 128. And that would be if you wanted a visor. But I find it interesting. Interesting psychology on how the pricing works for you to get their deal.
No doubt. I've definitely padded my orders before. I've noticed like Deal News does a lot of like, they do some great tips on how to pad and things like that. And and it's definitely part of like of deal psychology, like you said. Like, oh shoot, if I can only get up to this number, then I'd be able to get the thing that I wanted. In fact, maybe it'd be smart to, you know, include something that was super high margin at a low point price point, just so that people could pad orders. Like if that's one of your strategies, like that break point, getting to that break point.
Sure.
Add a really high margin item that's smaller, so that people will like constantly pad with that, and you'll make money on it.
There's two things that I want to point out that they're doing really well that I think could be, or one thing they could do better, but two things they're doing well. One is they have a, you know, admittedly, some things are really hard to purchase when you don't have a concrete idea of what you need. And so they make it very obvious to you that there is a questionnaire, like a Q&A sort of wizard to find, you know, the right type of shoe for you. And I see this more and more and more. And I don't see enough companies doing this. So this is effectively all this is. And Brian, we've had a few clients ask for something like this. All this is just more filters. Right. This is just filters. It's being presented in such a way that it helps it feel personalized to you, which I think really interesting. They're also, I like that they have really obvious price sorting, but for specifically in sale, I don't know if I'm the only person, but what I want to see is I want to be able to sort by the biggest deal. Like,
right.
I want to see
percentage off. Percentage off. Yeah, totally. No, I use that all the time on
dollars,
Amazon.
Dollars saved. Amazon. You know, just show me how I can save the most amount of money. Anyway, so I find that to be really interesting. I kind of like that brand. Yeah, I mean, it's not moving the needle for me. I just bought from them. But if you are looking to get a little bit of a deal, you're going to have to spend quite a bit more than $125, actually, is what it works out to for you to get the free beanie.
That's actually a great idea, though. Like, I think creating a free product that's almost like swag, mm-hmm. you know, essentially, once you hit a certain value, you become a large enough customer to get this swag, and you can't buy it anywhere else on the site, and it, you know, creates a little bit of exclusivity. I like that idea a lot. Yeah. That, for not just a Black Friday promotion, that's a good any day promotion.
Okay, so this is good. This has been really good. I want to give last word to our first time guest, digital marketing guru Lindsay Pugh. Tell us what's your any last words you have.
Hmm. I guess my last words would be just, you know, marketers are going to have to get a lot more creative with their content throughout the year. Yeah. I think it just goes back to everything that I always say all the time, and people get annoyed with me. It's like, marketing is not forcing people to buy shit that they don't want. It's giving them things that are useful that they actually do want and need, and helping them to find it. Like, it's all about making things easy for the consumer. And also having good content and nice things on your site year round, so that, you know, consumers know that they can count on you when busy sale times happen.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's just going to continue to be more of that. And as like Black Friday, Cyber Monday kind of disappears, you know, it's going to be a long tail strategy that marketers are going to have to deal with. So if you don't have good content now, you better up your game for 2018, or else it could make you crash and burn.
Positive outlook.
Great way to end this. Yes, I love it.
Black November.
Black year. I think, you know, this has been an interesting episode of Office Hours. We haven't even taken any questions as we kind of made it a surprise episode. So we are definitely going to have Lindsay back on at some point to answer your digital marketing questions and social questions and merchandising questions and things like that. So be ready. This is a nice little preview of her. And so we'll let you know when she's coming back on the show, so you can be prepared to ask her questions and get some good advice from her.
Yeah, that's great.
Thank you so much, Lindsay.
Lindsay, where can people find you on online if they want to reach out?
Probably just go to my about.me page. I think it's just about.me/Lindsay Pugh, and all my stuff is on there.
Awesome.
Great.
Thank you so much. Take us home, Brian.
All right. With that, we've concluded another session of Something Digital Office Hours, where you can ask us questions about Magento. We didn't really answer very many questions about Magento today, but there was some great content. I'm really glad we did this. So thank you for listening. And until next time, we'll see you.